Hello everyone, welcome to Unacademy's YouTube channel. Now let me wait, let me check if the stream is coming up in YouTube or not. After that we will start the class right away. Okay, stream is coming up in YouTube. People, today we are going to look at some of the most important topics in biotechnology for science and technology for the upcoming prelims examination. Okay, so we will look at all the important biotechnology topics that are important for the upcoming UPSC examination. Now, before going on to the topic itself, let me give you a brief introduction about myself as well as about Unacademy. See, my name is Aravind. I completed my BE Mechanical Engineering in 2014, and I have almost 3 years of experience in teaching UPSC Civil Services, and I have experienced all stages of UPSC Civil Services, that is prelims, mains, and then interview. Now my specialty subjects include polity, international relations, and then current affairs. Now if you wish to know more about my classes, now follow my schedule, and if you ask doubts regarding my classes, please join this group Unacademy underscore Aravind, where I will regularly update when I'm going to take my classes, and if you have any doubts you can ask in this group itself. So please consider joining this group, Unacademy underscore Aravind. Now what will you get by subscribing to Unacademy? See, by subscribing to Unacademy you will get access to daily live classes where you get to watch, rewatch, and you can ask doubts if you like on those live classes. And importantly, this rewatchability feature, it's not available with any offline institution. Okay, once you have attended a particular class, there is no way you can revisit the past classes. But with Unacademy, since it's an online platform, if you are having any doubt or if you did not understand a particular concept correctly, you can immediately go back and rewatch a particular class. Okay, so that's the advantage Unacademy provides you with. And then even with the doubts, okay, if you are having any doubts, you can ask doubts then and there itself if you have any with Unacademy. And then Unacademy conducts live tests as well as quizzes almost on a daily basis, so that you get to test yourself based on the examination point of view. And then all courses in Unacademy are structured courses. Okay, so that the learning process for the students becomes much easier. Okay, we will follow, we will go from A to B, B to C, C to D, rather than confusing the path of the students. Okay, so all courses in Unacademy are structured courses. And importantly, you will get unlimited access to videos concerned with examination that you are subscribing for. So if you are subscribing for UPSC, you will get unlimited access to videos concerned with UPSC examination. And also Unacademy serves as a platform where top educators like Pranal Patel, Mudit Gupta, Ayush Sanghi, all these top educators, they get to share their knowledge with students who hail from all over India. And Unacademy as a platform facilitates this exchange of information process. And also Unacademy covers syllabus in a very comprehensive manner. Okay, so each nook and corner of UPSC syllabus will be covered under Unacademy platform. Not only that, the same syllabus will be covered by multiple faculties. So if you're not satisfied with one faculty, you can immediately switch over to another faculty. Okay, so that's a choice that Unacademy provides you with. Okay, so in a way, Unacademy is trying to democratize the learning process itself by giving you the choice of choosing when to study, where to study, as well as with whom you want to study. Now guys, I suggest you download Unacademy learning app if you want to keep track of your learning goals. Okay, how much time you are spending in Unacademy, if your favorite teacher is going to take a class in Unacademy, you will get an immediate notification. So to keep track of all these important things, I suggest you download Unacademy learning app. Okay, and then now this is the amount that Unacademy charges you with. Okay, this is the amount Unacademy charges you. Okay, this is very less compared to offline institutions where you will be spending upwards of 4 to 5 lakh rupees. Okay, which includes the things like fees, rent, food, all these expenses. Okay, but with Unacademy, not only this upfront cost, that is fees, is very less, but you don't need to spend a dime on either rent or food because you will be learning from the comfort of your home itself. Okay, and on top of very meager sum that Unacademy is charging you with, okay, if you are using my code Aravind V, you will get 10% as offer. You will get 10% as offer. So please consider using my code ARAVIMB in case you want to subscribe for Unacademy. And Unacademy has recently introduced a new type of platform called as Iconic platform. Here Unacademy will assign you the personal coach. This personal coach is some of the most experienced faculty in UPSC field, and some have even cleared UPSC itself. So they know all about how to clear UPSC and what struggles student will face during the preparation of UPSC, all these things. So okay, so Iconic will be better if you feel that you need some personal guidance from Unacademy. Okay, so even here, if you're using my code ARAVIMB, you will get 10% as offer. Okay, okay, that's introduction and promotion done away with people. Let's move on to today's class. Okay, let's move on to today's class. Okay, so today's class, these are the topics that we are going to look in today's class. These are the topics that we are going to look at today's class: DNA profiling, gene therapy, mitochondrial DNA and nuclear DNA, gene drive technology, GM crops, regulation of GM crops in India, and all these different GM crops. Okay, so these are the topics that we are going to look at today. Now, moving to the first topic of today. The first topic of today is DNA profiling. Okay, so what is DNA profiling? Okay, so DNA profiling or DNA fingerprint is a creation of biometric database comprising of DNA information of individual. Okay, so it's simply a collection of DNA data. Okay, it's a simply collection of DNA data, and that DNA data will be used to identify a particular individual. Okay, now if you look at the establishment of DNA profiles, how DNA profiles are being established. While DNA is unique to an individual genetic makeup, it is 99.9% similar between all individuals within the human species. The variable regions, that is 0.1%, also called as variable number of tandem repeats that are unique to individual's DNA, constitute the DNA profile of that particular individual. Okay, so 99.9% of DNA is similar to all of humanity, but there is a difference in 0.1%. Okay, so in DNA profiling, we will study, okay, how and in each individual's the DNA profile is different from one another based on this variable number of tandem repeats. Now, the DNA profile of an individual varies in some regions, in terms of number of times sequence of nucleotide bases repeated. Okay, now thus by counting the number of times these base pair sequences are repeated in these variable regions, a DNA profile of an individual is established. Okay, see ATCG. Okay, this is the sequence of any DNA. Okay, DNA is arranged in this sequence. Okay, so by studying how this sequence, okay, for example TC, GA, how these sequences are being arranged in each individual, based on that only we will determine each individual's INT. Okay, that is, so that's what they are saying here. Okay, DNA profile of an individual varies in some regions in terms of number of times a sequence of nucleotide base pairs is repeated. Okay, and then thus by counting the number of times these pair sequences are repeated in these variable regions of DNA, the profile of an individual is established. Okay, now what is the application of DNA profiling? What are the applications of DNA profiling? The first one is to establish the identity of persons. Okay, by profiling DNA, we can easily identify which person is who. And also, DNA profiling helps in determining biological relationship to establish parentage, viability of organ transplantation, etc. Okay, so DNA profiling, there are two main uses. One is to establish identity of an individual, the next one is to establish biological relationship of that particular individual as well as viability of organ transplantation. Okay, now how does genes work? Now every cell in an organism contains all of the information needed to manufacture every protein in the body. Okay, now the gene in the strands of DNA are storehouse of that information, also called as it's an instruction book. Okay, see here, every cell, okay, they have the information which that is required to manufacture protein in the body. Okay, every cell has that information. Now that information, okay, that information is stored in a particular area called as genes. Okay, so genes is nothing but an instruction book. Now the genes that contains organism carries for a particular trait in its genotype, and the physical manifestation of the instructions are organism's phenotype. Okay. Now further, a gene, a sequence of bases in sections of DNA after the phenotype in two main steps. One is transcription, in which a copy of gene's base sequence is made. The next one is translation, in which a copy is used to direct the production of protein. Okay, so these are the two steps based on which a gene will produce protein. Okay. Now in transcription, the gene's base sequence or code is copied into middleman molecule, also called as messenger RNA. Good morning Ram Kumar. Now in translation, okay, in transcription period, this is what is happening. In translation, what happens is that in translation, the mRNA that was produced earlier moves out of the nucleus and into the cytoplasm of a particular cell, where the messages encoded in the mRNA molecules are used to build proteins. Okay, so this is how genes will build proteins. First one, what they will do is that they will use the sequence of a code, and they will copy this code into a middleman called as mRNA. Okay, so what happens? Gene, okay, they will encode this information into mRNA. Now this stage is called as transcription. Now after this mRNAs are being transcribed, what happens is that mRNAs, they will move out of the nucleus and they will attach into cytoplasm of the cell. Okay, now where these messages are encoded into the mRNA molecules are used to build proteins, this process is called as translation. Okay. Now what is genome sequences? Now we have studied what is gene. Now next thing we will discuss is what is genome sequences, genome sequencing. Now the full set of DNA present in an individual organism is called as genome. Okay, a full set of DNA present in an individual organism is called as genome. Now DNA sequencing is a procedure for determining the linear order of nucleotide bases in DNA. Okay, so DNA sequencing, what they will do is that they will determine the linear order in which nucleotide bases in DNA are being arranged. Now the sequencing a gene is like reading a book one letter at a time to look for any spelling mistake. So they will look for any abnormalities. Okay, in genome sequencing they will look at what are the abnormalities present in a particular DNA set. So by mapping out these abnormalities, what will happen? Okay, by mapping out what were these abnormalities, we can determine, okay, which abnormality is responsible for a particular disease. Okay, which abnormality is responsible for a particular trait in a human body. Okay, so mapping out a person's entire genetic code or a genome, in other words, reading each of 3 billion base pairs that make up of person's genetic code is called as genome sequencing. Now by creating a genome sequence, we will be able to test specific genes to detect the presence of mutations associated with genetic disorders. Okay, so by having genome sequences, as I mentioned before, what can we do? We can determine which specific genome sequence is responsible for which genetic disorders. Now within the next few years, experts expect the turnaround time to improve and the cost to drop so much that analyzing a person's genome will be no more expensive than zeroing on just one genome. Okay, so in future, many people are expecting that genome sequencing will be a lot more cheaper as well as cost effective. Okay, so that's what they are trying to say here. Now the next, within genome sequencing, we will look at next generation sequencing. See, next generation sequencing simply refers to DNA sequencing techniques that decode multiple DNA fragments at the same time in an automated process. Okay, automated process. Okay, so the multiple DNA fragments are being examined in an automated process, that is next gen sequencing. As a result of next gen sequencing, procedures are fast, accurate as well as cheap, and they are automated. Okay, so this is the advantage of next generation sequencing. Okay, Now, next topic that we are going to look at is gene therapy. Now, gene therapy involves removal of defective stem cells from patient's bone marrow. Okay, so here, as I mentioned before, in genome sequences, what are we trying to do? We are looking for abnormalities, and we will study which abnormality is responsible for which genetic disease. Okay, so by studying this abnormalities, what can we do? If we are removing this abnormality from our genes, what can we do? We are eliminating this disease. Okay, that is called as gene therapy. Now, gene therapy involves removal of defective stem cells from patient's bone marrow. Now, stem cells are removed or genetically modified for correction. Now, the genetically modified cells are infused back into the bone marrow using a virus vector. Now, the corrected stem cells in the bone marrow develop healthy blood cells. Okay, so these corrected cells, what will they do? They have the required genome sequencing to produce protein. So, based on the corrected genome sequencing, what can they do? They can produce proteins based on the corrected version of gene. Now, the next topic that we are going to look at is mitochondrial DNA and nuclear DNA. Now, so far the DNA we have been referring to is the DNA that is present in the nucleus. In addition to DNA in the nucleus, some DNA is also present in the mitochondria. Now, during fertilization, the nuclear DNA, nuclear DNA with 46 chromosomes that is formed where 23 chromosomes is inherited from the mother and 23 from the dad, okay. So, 23 chromosomes will come from mom, 23 chromosomes will come from dad, and both of them combined will form nuclear DNA, where a nuclear DNA will have almost 46 DNA. Now, mitochondrial DNA only has one chromosomes and it codes for only one specific protein responsible for metabolism. Okay, so if you look at nuclear DNA, it has 46 chromosomes, but with mitochondrial DNA, it has only one chromosome and it codes only for specific proteins that are responsible for metabolism. What is the meaning of metabolism? Producing energy. Okay. So, mitochondrial DNA are responsible only for producing energy, nothing else. Now, it is a nuclear DNA that is responsible for inheritance. Okay, nuclear DNA is responsible for inheritance. What is the meaning of inheritance? You will contribute 23 chromosomes to your baby. That is called as inheritance. That is from both father as well as mother. Now, mitochondrial DNA is inherited only from the mother, and thus it has to be more effective to trace human ancestry. Okay, if you look at nuclear DNA, it is coming from both father and mother, but if you look at mitochondrial DNA, it is inherited only from mother. Okay, so by that way, if you are studying mitochondrial DNA, you can easily trace back one's human ancestry. Okay, so that's what they are trying to say here. Now, the next one is three-parent baby technique. Now, apart from receiving the usual nuclear DNA from the mother and father, as I mentioned in my previous topic itself, a person will receive both sets of gene, okay, 23 chromosomes from my father, 23 from his mother. After receiving these 46 DNA, a nuclear DNA will be formed. See, apart from receiving the usual nuclear DNA from its mother and father, the embryo would also include a small amount of healthy mitochondrial DNA from a woman donor. Okay, so woman, apart from giving nuclear chromosomes to do nuclear DNA, they will also provide mitochondrial DNA for the children. Now, this is resorted to when the actual mother is suffering from an incurable mitochondrial disease. Okay, so if mother is responsible for giving mitochondrial DNA, but if the mother is suffering from any mitochondrial based disease, okay, if she is suffering from mitochondrial disease, then the three parent baby technique will be used. Now, this technique involves removing the faulty mitochondrial DNA from the actual mother and nucleus from the mother's egg, and the resultant egg fertilizes with the sperm cell of the father outside the body. Okay. What is the we will remove, okay, we will remove what is the faulty mitochondrial DNA, and we will also take the sperm from the father, and we will grow this baby outside of the body. That is, outside of the body means outside of human body. That is called as three parent baby technique. Now the next topic that we are going to look today is stem cells. See, stem cells, the most basic unit of any organism is a cell. Okay. Now, cell is the smallest unit of life that can function independently and can perform all the necessary functions of the life. Okay. Now, cells develop to form tissues, which in turn develop into organs. Okay. Now, broadly speaking, cells are of two types. One is differentiated, another one is undifferentiated. Now, differentiated cells are the building blocks of tissues and organs and are specialized to from that tissue or organ. Okay, these are specialized to tissues that are responsible for building up of a specific organ or tissues. Okay, now undifferentiated cells are those that have potential to develop into many different types of cells, like those in muscles, kidney, or liver. Okay. Now, stem cells are basically these undifferentiated primitive cells. Okay, stem cells are basically these undifferentiated primitive cells. Okay, so they have the potential to develop into many forms of cells. Okay, stem cells, they have the potential to form any organ in the body. That's why the stem cell is very important. Okay, now further, stem cells are of two types: embryonic and adult somatic stem cells. Did you understand this one, everyone? See, a cell is the most basic organism in a human body. Okay, cell is responsible for building up of tissues, organs, all these things. Okay, now cells are differentiated into two types of cells. One is differentiated and another one is undifferentiated. Okay, differentiated, they are very specific. Okay, so if there is a cell which is responsible for the organ of liver, it can build only liver. It cannot build any other tissue, or it cannot build any other organ. But with undifferentiated cells, these are capable of building any organ or tissues in the body. Okay, so that's why stem cells are important in human research. Why? Because some stem cells are undifferentiated cells, undifferentiated primitive cells. So if you are having a stem cell, you can recreate the organs. Any organ. Now, further, stem cells are also of two types. One is embryonic and the next one is adult somatic stem cells. Now, the next topic that we're going to look today is induced pluripotent stem cells and their significance. See, IPS are adult stem cells, okay, like an umbilical cord cells or bone marrow cells that can be induced to show properties of stem cells. Okay, so this induced pluripotent stem cells, they can be induced to show the properties of stem cells. Now, they are mostly used in therapeutic cloning to treat degenerative diseases like diabetes, Parkinson's, and Alzheimer's. Okay, so these IPS, induced pluripotent stem cells, are mainly used to treat diseases like diabetes, Alzheimer's, as well as Parkinson's disease. Now, these induced pluripotent cells are created by stimulating mature, already specialized cells back into a juvenile state without the help of an embryo. Okay. Now, these can be derived from the patient themselves, making them less likely to be rejected. These cells can be transformed into a range of different types of cells, and their use is key in a sector like medical research. Now, further, moving to ethical issues, embryonic cells are banned in countries such as Ireland and in Latin America. Now, therefore, the use of IPS cells in therapeutic cloning is rather significant. Okay, so these IPS cells can be used for cloning itself. So what is the significance of stem cell therapies? Now, currently, the available therapies for Parkinson's disease treat symptoms without slowing or halting the disease progression. On the other hand, new research aims to actively reverse the disease itself. Okay, so the current medicine involves reducing the rate of this disease. Okay, it is not trying to cure, it is trying to only reduce the rate of disease. They are trying to halt the disease progression, but with new techniques, okay, with new techniques as well as new research, they are trying to reverse the process of the disease itself. Okay, people, give me a moment here. I'll drink some water. Okay, so give me a moment here. Now people see here, next one is in vivo gene editing. Now recently gene editing was carried out inside a human body for the very first time to treat Hunter's syndrome. Now the zinc finger nucleases technique was used to insert the corrective gene in the DNA of the patient through intravenous therapy, that is called as IV gene editing. Now this gene editing was used to treat Hunter's syndrome. Now what is the technique used? Zinc finger nucleases technique. Okay, now there are different techniques that are used to gene editing. Okay, there are different techniques that are used for gene editing. One such technique is called as CRISPR-Cas9. Okay, now this type of gene editing is a revolutionary gene editing technique. Now this is short for clustered regulatory interspaced short palindromic repeats. Now CRISPR uses an enzyme called as CAAS9 to cut strands of DNA at precisely the targeted locations and to insert new genetic material into the gap. Okay, so if as I mentioned before, if this is DNA sequencing, okay, if this is DNA sequencing, okay, they will look at the defective sequence, they will look at the defective sequence. Now Cas9 will be used to cut this portion of DNA and also to insert new DNA which will try to rectify that particular disease. Now CRISPR-9 is a replica of the natural process when a virus infects a bacterium. Okay, if this is bacteria, what happens in relationship between virus and bacteria? Virus it will attach itself to a bacteria, and this virus, it will inject its RNA into bacteria, thereby infecting the bacteria. Am I being clear? Virus are single cell organisms, right? So what is the job of virus? Virus is basically a dead organism, but it comes to alive whenever it is attached to another organism. So when virus is attached to a bacteria, what will happen? It will immediately release its RNA into the bacteria. So this is a similar type of technique is being used in CRISPR technique. Now the bacterium has evolved the CRISPR or Cas9 system to be a adaptive immune system. Okay, so if this is bacteria, the virus will be, this is virus, okay, this is a virus. I'll zoom in here. This is virus. Okay, now after this injection of virus, bacteria gets transformed into this CRISPR, okay, also called as Cas9. Okay, now this will be, okay, this double helix structure will be straightened to form gRNA. Okay, so this will be used to target the DNA. Okay, by means of targeting DNA, they will remove the defective parts of the DNA with the corrected versions. Okay, so this Cas9, right, this Cas9 will be used to deliver the correct DNA sequence. Now the next topic that we are going to look at is GM crops. Now transgenic GM plants are those that have been genetically modified using recombinant DNA technology. Now genetic modification is done to confer a particular trait to the plant with one of the following properties. Okay, So these are the following properties that are desired from GM crops. One is to increase the yield of the crop, increased nutrition content of the crop, developing resistance to abiotic stresses like temperature, salinity, and herbicide resistant. Okay, so these are the uses of GM crops. They will try to increase the yield of a crop, they will try to increase the nutrient content of a crop, as well as they will try to increase the resistance of a particular crop to abiotic stresses like temperature, salinity, and herbicide resistance. Now, biotic stresses like insect resistant crops can also be manufactured. Now, BT cotton is the only genetically modified crop that is being commercially allowed in India from 2002. Okay, so BT cotton is the only GM crop that is currently being allowed to grow in India. Okay, right from 2002 itself. Now, if you look at the regulation of genetically modified organisms in India, genetically modified organisms and the products thereof are regulated under the Environment Protection Act of 1986. Okay, so GM crops. Okay, this is very, very important, which can be asked in your prelims examination. GM crops are currently regulated by Environment Protection Act of 1986. Okay, so keep this in mind, it is very important. Okay, now why was this particular act was passed? This particular act was passed because of a subsequent international arrangement called as Cartagena Protocol. So to basically implement this Cartagena Protocol, this act was passed. Since India is also a signatory to Cartagena Protocol on biosafety, okay, India adopted these biosafety rules under Environment Protection Act in 1989 called Rules for Manufacture, Use, Import, Export and Storage of Hazardous Microorganisms, Genetically Engineered Organisms or Cells. Now, according to genetic technology, genetic engineering includes gene editing and gene drives are regulated under Environment Protection Act in India. Okay. So this is the regulation of GMO. Okay, what is the statutory backing regarding regulation of GMO in India? Okay, now what are the authorities which are responsible for regulating GM crops? Now, if you look at regulatory authorities, GM crops. Okay, GM crops are regulated by Genetical Engineering Appraisal Committee, which is under Ministry of Environment and Forest. Okay, this is very, very important. Many people think that Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee will come under Ministry of Science and Technology. It is wrong. It comes under Ministry of Environment and Forests. Okay. Now, this Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee, okay, also known as GEAC, it is a final approval authority for environmental release of GM crops in India, including confined field trials. It also includes approval for commercial cultivation of GM crops. So, if you want to introduce GM crops in India, or if you want to obtain the permission of having a trial run, field trials for GM crops in India, you can't do so without the approval of GEAC. Okay, so GEAC approval is very important for approval of commercial cultivation of GM crops as well as field trials of GM crops. Now, GM crops are regulated by this organization. Now, if you look at GM food, genetically modified food, Food and Safety and Standards Authority of India regulates the manufacture, storage, distribution, sale, and import of genetically modified food. Okay, so the food produced from genetically modified crops, okay, they are regulated by FSSAI. Now, BT cotton is the only genetically modified crop that is commercially allowed in India to be grown from 2002. Now, BT cotton is grown in India, is genetically modified for developing resistance to pink bollworm pest in the crop. Okay, so cotton plants are notorious for their attacks from pink bollworm pest. Okay, so this BT cotton is pretty resistant to, they are genetically engineered so that they are resistant to this particular pest. Okay, now this type of this type of editing is done by means of inserting CRY1AB and CRY2BC genes from soil bacterium called as Bacillus thuringiensis into cotton seed. Okay, so we have taken this DNA, we have taken these genes from this bacteria called as Bacillus thuringiensis, and we have inserted these genes into cotton. Okay, so by inserting these genes, what has happened? Okay, these plants have become resistant to pink bollworm pest. Let's take a look at some information on BT cotton. Now, BT cotton is short for herbicide resistant BT cotton. Now, the cotton seed is inserted with CPR EPS PS gene from soil bacterium called as Agrobacterium. Okay, so the first one is, so the first thing that we have learned is BT cotton. Okay, the next one is HTBT cotton. Okay, now, in what happens in HTBT cotton here, the CP4 EPS PS. Okay, this is obtained from a soil bacterium called as Agrobacterium tubifacins. Now, this produced a modified protein glycophosphate which makes it herbicide resistance. Okay, now this is not allowed to be cultivated in India. Okay, this type of BT cotton, okay, this BT cotton manufactured by means of this particular gene is not allowed to be cultivated in India. Now, the next topic, so far we have discussed BT cotton. Okay, now the next topic that we are going to discuss today is BT brinjal. Okay, now BT brinjal is a genetically engineered, this brinjal is genetically engineered by inserting a gene from soil bacterium called as Bacillus thuringiensis for insecticidal property. Okay, for this insecticidal property, they are being this particular gene has been introduced into brinjal. Okay, what is the meaning of insectarianal property? Insects will not attack brinjals. Okay, that is the meaning of insecticidal property. Now, this gene disrupts the digestive system of the insect that feeds on the crop, thus killing the insect itself. Okay, so if any insect that is trying to eat the BT brinjal, they will die. Okay, so what is the problem with that? If you are killing insects in the field, what will happen? Pollination will not occur, insect population will decline. Okay, so it will destroy the entire ecosystem. Okay, so that's why since 2010 itself, there have been an indefinite moratorium on commercial cultivation of BT brinjal in India. Why? Because it is too dangerous for the environment. If you are introducing BT brinjal in our Indian environment, it will prove very dangerous because it has a potential to kill insects that are feeding from BT brinjal. And if you are killing insects, so ecosystems have the ecosystems of particular area will collapse. Now, okay, people, okay, if you have any doubts so far, please ask your doubts. Okay, I will try to answer those. After that, I will move on to the next part. Okay, if you have any doubts so far, please ask your doubts, everyone. Okay, since you guys are not asking any doubts, I will move on to the topic. Okay, now the next topic that we are going to look at is National Stem Cell Registry. Now, India is developing a National Stem Cell Registry of its own. Okay, now this is a government managed database of unrelated bone marrow donors. Okay, now the main aim is to find matching donors for treating patients with blood related disorders such as blood cancers, thalassemia, sickle cell anemia, as well as hemophilia. Okay, so similar to blood bank, okay, where blood of different individuals is being stored in blood bank, central government is trying to create a National Stem Cell Registry. Okay, so this National Stem Cell Registry, it will have all the information of a individual's stem cell. So if any person is required stem cells for treating blood based disorders, they can approach stem cell and they will look at the database and they will look for compatible stem cells. Okay, so that's the importance of National Stem Cell Registry. Now, this Registry can be used to treat diseases like blood cancer, called as lymphoma or leukemia, thalassemia, sickle cell anemia, hemophilia. Okay, so to treat all these diseases, okay, we need stem cells from healthy donors. Okay, so using this National Stem Cell Registry, we can easily obtain that stem cell from another person. Now, what is the importance of this stem cell registry? Of course, Naveen, I am trying to cover all the important topics, Naveen. Okay, I have already completed technology topics. This is biotechnology topics. Okay. Now, around 3 to 5 lakh people suffer from blood-related issues such as thalassemia, which require frequent blood transfusions. Now, the only cure for blood-related disorders is bone marrow transplantation. Okay, so for that you have to find matching donors. Okay, now for that you have to find matching donors. Now, for bone marrow transplantation, the donor and the patient should have exactly the same white blood cell type. Okay, they should have exactly the same white blood cell type. Now, siblings usually have the exact match and thus are suitable for bone marrow transplantation. Thus, matching donors is extremely low, okay, and the database will help connect unrelated matching donors. Okay, so for beyond their own siblings, okay, it is very difficult to determine which person is having their identical DNA. Okay, so to find matching donors, this registry will be used by number of people, that is National Stem Cell Registry, everyone. Now, the next topic that we are going to look at is biobank. Okay, now biobank is a repository that accepts, processes, stores and distributes biospecimens and related data for academic and clinical uses. Okay, so this biobank will have various biospecimens as well as related information. Now, this information as well as specimens are used for academic as well as clinical uses. Now, starting with small laboratory based biobanks catering to research the needs of specific projects, the field of biobanking is flourishing tremendously in the recent years. Now, large scale biorepositories have been created in order to collect, analyze, store phenotypic and genetic information of representative samples from around the globe. Now, the current age biobanks are government supported commercial population based virtual biobanks. Now, virtual biobanks are electronic databases that help investigators to locate biospecimens and data mining from multiple biobanks. Now, biospecimen can include anything such as DNA, RNA, tissue, cell linens, proteins, phenotypes from healthy or deceased individuals, etc. Okay, everyone, that's it for today's topic. Okay, that's it for today. Okay, I've completed all my topics. Okay, I'll give you 2 to 3 minutes to ask your doubts. If you have any doubts, please ask right now. After that, I'm going to end this session. People, please ask your doubts, okay? After that, I'm going to end the session, everyone. People, please ask your doubts. Okay, I have given you 2 to 3 minutes to ask your doubts. Okay, I have finished the class. So please, if you have any, ask your doubts. Otherwise, I'm going to end this session. Okay, everyone, I have given you ample amount of time to ask your doubts. Okay, so since you guys have not asked doubts, okay, I'm going to end this stream. Okay, I'm going to end this stream. Goodbye, everyone. Have a wonderful day. See you tomorrow.